Good afternoon, everyone. ITEC welcomes all the participants for today's National Distance Learning Seminar Series. Today's topic is Counselling Issues in Adolescents, and speaker is Dr. Kalpana Datta. Dr. Kalpana Datta serves as Professor of Pediatric Medicine and Program Director of Pediatric Center of Excellence, Medical College and Hospital, Kolkata. She is a National Trainer of Malnutrition, Adolescent Reproductive Sexual Health, and also Specialist Trainer in Pediatric HIV. Dr. Kalpana is a guide for thesis project and research and adjudicator for postgraduate thesis recognized examiner for UG and PG. She has several publications in national and international journals and has presented many scientific papers at various conferences. We welcome you, ma'am, for today's NDLS session. I would request Dr. Kalpana now to kindly take over the session.
Okay, good afternoon. Today's my topic is the issue. Counseling issues in adolescence. For the last 1 year, 1 hour, I'll be talking on counseling, different issues related to adolescence and what are the counseling part related to adolescence. And the first, let us discuss what do you mean by adolescence. According to the WHO, defines adolescence as the period of life between 10 to 19 years, and it is a transient period from the childhood to self-sufficient adulthood. And time of physiological maturation, becoming adult like in behavior, and period of rapid physical and biological changes, which may lead to lots of confusion, tension, frustration, feeling of insecurity. So this is the period of stress and strain. Adolescence again divided in three parts: early adolescent, mid adolescent, and late adolescent. In early adolescent, it is 10 to 14 years, 14 to 17 is the mid adolescent, and 17 to 19 is the late adolescent. And this classification is done to identify the problems in different part of the adolescent. Because in the early adolescent, they are 10 to 14 years, there is a rapid growth in the physical maturation and sexual maturation, but it's still not completed. So there's a rapidly changing body structure, both internally and externally. So there's a tendency to have a risky behavior. And they are very much self-conscious, they are shy, they need privacy and relationship with the friends, and spend more time with the peers and the friends than the parents. And there is a lots of sexual curiosity in between 10 to 14 years. In case of 14 to 17 years, they are having developed sexual organs, both externally and internally, and the puberty is achieved by 17 years in all the teens. And they are extremely conscious about their external appearance, look. They are very much conscious. They spend many more time in front of the mirrors and their own attitude, and I mean the attire, the dress up and the look. They spend more time on physical appearance and want to be independent. So they don't want to be dependent by the parents and all dominated by parents. This is the phase, that is the 15 to 17 years, they want to be independent, and there is a chance of having risky behaviors, sexual exposures and the drug abuse. Then again the 17 to 19, where they are almost like an adult, they are mature enough, but still there is a some immaturity regarding the decision making, abstract thinking, reasoning, because frontal lobe takes place, the development of frontal lobe takes place, completes by 24 to 25 years. So there is the imbalance between the different the growth and development of the different parts of the body along with the different parts of the brain also. In case of limbic system, the maturity of the limbic system completes by 18 to 19 years, whereas the frontal lobe matures by 24 years. So they are more impulsive, more emotional, but as the frontal lobe is yet to mature completely, so there is a lack of taking the good decision, reasoning, abstract thinking and judgment. So adolescence is the phase is itself in a crisis phase, and there are many issues that the adolescent face in today's society, because it's a changing character society now. The digital media is more prevalent than the other type of exposures, so they have lots of anxiety, present challenging problems and or require difficult decision making, and each individual adolescent are different, and they deal these problems in a different way. So there is a differently with these subjects. For some, the matter may be insignificant, they can handle very easily, while it becomes a crisis for others, and it may sometimes lead to crisis in the family also. Now there is some data about the adolescents. It is the one 16% of world population is contributed by the adolescents. A huge number, and they are the future citizen or the future maker of the country. So adolescent and young people means after 24 years is a growing share of patient people living with HIV in the worldwide. In 2018, 510,000 young people between 10 to 24 years were newly infected with HIV, and 1.6 million adolescents are living with HIV, whereas 190,000 are newly infected and 33,000 are dying due to AIDS related causes. WHO has estimated the different causes. The first 10 causes in adolescent, and they again divided with the sex, male and female, with the cause a bit vary with the male and female, and they also divided in two groups in the early adolescent and late adolescents, 10 to 14 and 15 to 19. So I've taken the five topmost causes of mortality in female child. If you look to this bar chart, in 10 to 14 years, the commonest cause of death in a female child in between 10 to 14 years is the HIV AIDS related disease, then the road traffic accidents, then of course the pneumonia, diarrhea and other infectious diseases like malaria and all. But if you look at the 15 to 19 years, the maternal conditions, especially in females like teenage marriage, early exposure, sexual exposure, teenage marriage, early pregnancy, teenage pregnancy, that will lead to lots of complication during pregnancy, abortion, and the septic abortion, unsafe abortion is quite common in teenage girl child. And then of course the delivery related complications. So maternal condition is the top the list in case of 15 to 19 years. And then second is the suicide or self-harm. Is the second common, and then of course the is a female child, the road traffic accident is the third in the list, then diarrheal disease, tuberculosis and other respiratory tract illness. But if you compare with the male child, if you see the male adolescents in again in 10 to 14 years and in between 15 to 19 years, if you see the road traffic accident is the commonest cause of death in 10 to 14 years. That is the commonest cause worldwide. The commonest cause of non-communicable disease in adolescents is the road traffic accident. So road traffic accident is the top of the list. Then drowning means a suicidal tendency. Either by drowning, hanging and taking poison or insecticides and all is very common in 10 to 14 years because they are very much emotional. And the frontal lobe is not much matured. So any small part of it is scolding from the parents, any disharmony in the family, any problem in the day-to-day activities, any problem in the school or with the from the teacher, they very much depressed and takes the some suicidal activity. And in case of 14 years male child, it is that HIV is the third cause, and then pneumonia and diarrheal diseases. While if you consider 15 to 19 years, if you see the road traffic accidents quite high, as they are more on the time spending on the outside and the roads, and they are not following the traffic rules and all. They are very rash driver, or they take adventurous. They want to do some adventure and all. So the road traffic accident top the list. Interpersonal violence also very common in male child, especially in 15 to 19 years, because of the competition, because of the smoking, alcohol abuse, drug substance abuse and others. Then third is the suicidal tendency by self-harming or drowning, and fifth is the cause of death in 15 to 19 years. So HIV prevalence in if you consider in 15 to 24 years is a 21% of whereas the, below 14 years is a 6% and rest is the 73%. So adolescent HIV is a separate epidemic and needs to be handled and managed separately from adult HIV. Not only from the adult HIV, also it should be managed separately from the pediatric HIV, because adolescent period is such a period, if you ask them to go in a pediatric OPD, there is always in confusion which OPD they will go, either pediatric OPD or adult OPD. They are not pediatric patients, they are not adult patients. When they go in a pediatric patient, they don't get the priority. They will say, oh, you are adolescent, you are quite old enough, you stand in the behind. And when you go to the general OPD, adult OPD, okay, you are young enough, you go and stand in the behind. So they are always neglected. So it is a very important issue that they are to be dealt very delicately. And it need to be handled with the separate motto, separate idea, separate, it should be, if possible, separate outdoor also, and separate counselling session. as not only they face problems in accepting their HIV status, because they are adolescent, they quite know about the HIV, may have some myths and false beliefs, need for lifelong treatment and other positive family members, not only for her or himself, also for the family members, but also have a sad memories of their lost parent, because usually they get the infection from the parents, as one or the both parents are died because of the HIV. So that part also very much important for them, because they are having lots of family burden and a big question mark in future regarding health, education, career and marriage. Adolescence is the period where everyone have an idea of about their education, career, marriage or in future, and over and above they are suffering from HIV. So very stressful situation for the adolescent, and it's an individual who gets infected with HIV once but stays infected and affected for whole life. So this is a separate epidemic the adolescents are having. So why is a separate epidemic, or we say a newly emerging population? Because of the better early infant diagnosis, better recognition of the newborn or infants, and early infant diagnosis is quite easy nowadays, and because of the programmatic issues, more sensitization the pediatricians, so they are more aware of the pediatric HIV, they refer in time and all, and large scale free availability of ART, so they survive till adolescent and young adult. So more and more babies are coming towards the adolescent phase, so it is a new emerging epidemics, and there are about 2.1 million living with the HIV in India. So what are the mode of transmission in adolescent? If you see, the maximum is the 67% from the vertical transmission from the parents. It is near about 67%. Next is the 14 is the unknown. Is there any something wrong? The 14 is unknown. That means okay, I'm continuing. The net speed is very slow. Okay, so I'll say a bit slowly. So it is a 14% of the unknown cause. But you should remember this: out of this 14% of unknown cause, maximum may be are sexually abused, because the sexual abuse are not highlighted. Even the parents can should not. They don't want to disclose it even to the healthcare providers. So it unknown cases. Sometimes we have received many cases without knowing the root, and after too much interrogation to the parents, repeated interrogation, then they accept it. It is sexually abused. So in the unknown group, lots of cases percentages are because of the sexually abused adolescent. Then the next is the one time blood transfusion. So they just see they are the innocent victim, because we have a one ELISA testing and it might be missed in an incubation period. So because of different issues, when they receive the blood transfusion, they may get infected with the HIV infection, while that is contributed by the 10%. Then the thalassemia child, the thalassemia adolescent are also innocent victims, because they take the regular blood transfusion by which they can receive the hepatitis B, C along with the HIV infection. This contributes about the 4%, and probable unsafe injections near about 1%. Though the drug users is less in number, but still it is there in some part of the pockets of the state, different states, and that is intravenous drug users is 1%, and few cases are not tested. Because this is the phase of denial, so they are not tested and not known the what is the route of transmission. So challenges of adolescent living in HIV. So adolescent period is still a challenge to be a good human being with a good health, good mental, sexual, menstrual health, social health, and over and above they are infected with the HIV. So HIV is still a challenge, and adolescent is still a challenge. When both comes together, this is a big challenge. So challenges of adolescents are need for autonomy. They want to be autonomous and independent. New cognitive capacity, loss of development is there, exposure is there, experimentation is there, evolving decisional capacity, struggle for independence, questions authority. They can question the authority of doctors and the parents, need to identify the peers, preoccupation with the self-image, and this is the phase where there is a risk-taking behaviors are quite high. Whereas if you consider the challenges due to HIV infection, it is a chronic disease requiring daily medication for whole life, long-term morbidities related to both HIV itself or opportunistic infection and due to the treatment also. associated adverse socio-economic circumstances, disparities in the population characteristics, and there's a associated stigma. Now, as the counseling issues are there in adolescent, so what do you mean by counseling? It's helping people to identify their problem, make decisions, and giving them confidence to put their decision into practice. So it's not a advice. You have to identify why the adolescent has come, what is the problem he is having, what the disease he is suffering from. So you have to identify the problem. And you help the adolescent to take the decision. You will tell the options, the consequences, the advantages and disadvantages, so that it will help them to take a decision. And so and they will get a confidence about taking decision, and so that they can put their decision into practice, and that is called counseling. So there are some principles of counseling. The first part is to help the client to identify the problem and make decision for himself and herself. What happens? Might have some STI, bleeding for penile urethra, or itching in the vagina. Say they will come to the doctor or the counselor, but they won't disclose that. They will say, I am having my acne on my face and all, because they are very shy, very introvert, they don't want to disclose. So it is the counselor's duty to identify the problem and help them to take decision for himself or herself. The client has a right to choose his or her own action. Accurate information is provided. There are lots of myths and false beliefs in the adolescent, because they collect the information through Googleopathy or going through the books or different type of not scientific books, and getting some information from the peers and from other people. So they have lots of confusions, a wrong belief, and that should be removed, and accurate information should be provided by the counselor. And it is strictly confidential. So we have to maintain the confidentiality. As such, adolescents are very much concerned about themselves. Whenever they walk, they go, they think that everyone is watching them. And whatever they do, everyone is looking at them. So they are very much concerned about them. And this is moreover, they are suffering from HIV. They are very much aware of the society. So the counselor's duty to maintain the confidentiality, and it should be the adolescent should be confident enough that my counselor is not going to disclose anything, whatever I will say in this session, and take into account psychosocial, financial, spiritual needs of the client. So when the adolescent comes to the clinic or in the counselor's part, it is our duty, healthcare provider's duty, to take a complete history, give a comprehensive care, not only for which the baby has come, like some medicinal problem, but always take into the consideration of psychosocial issues, financial issues, and if there's any spiritual needs of the client, and that can help his or her well-being. So why there's a counseling, and what are the issues of the counseling? So to know the issues of counseling, first we have to know what are the problems they are facing, or what are the vulnerable things they are exposed to. So what is the adolescent vulnerability? The first and foremost is the behavioral vulnerability and mental health problem. Because lots of tension in there, because adolescent period is a period of having lots of activities. They are very busy in the school, tuition, extracurricular activities, game, playing, football, whatever they like. Then they spend much more time in the outside the home, away from the parents, always busy with the peers or the teachers or the trainers. So there's lots of behavioral vulnerability and mental health problem, because as I already said, there's a disparity in the development, the different parts of the brain. Then as there's a gradual development of the external physical character, internal physical sexual characters, there's hormonal changes. So there is lots of curiosity, and they can have a sexual experimentation vulnerability. Then gender power imbalance. There is a gender power imbalance that's in a sexual interaction is increasingly being recognized as a factor, and that will fill to the spread of HIV AIDS. So gender power imbalance must be removed, and that will increase the number of unsafe sexual interactions or encounters. So these they are more prone to develop a gender power imbalance vulnerability. Then there are chances of high risk behavior, as they are very much curious, very much adventurous. They want to have an experience of the things which are easily available. So there is a chances of having high and passing more time outside the home. So there are chances of high risk behavior. And The suicide, again, it is a mental health problem because of the lots of competition in this world, because of the net, digital world, because of the education. And economical disparity between the two adolescents, and comparative, always they are comparative with the other peers, so they might go in a depression and can commit suicide. That addiction to alcohol, drugs, tobacco, substance use, they are very much prone to these addictions. While counseling, we should consider these issues. And of course, the biological vulnerability, because there is lots of biological changes and they might be abused by the others. Anatomical and physiological vulnerability, like in anatomical, I can give one example. As the child, especially in female child, when they grow, there's a development of breast and all, so they want to hide. So what they will do, they will bend forward, and there may be a hunching back. So you ask them to, no, it's a normal, you just walk straight. So this is the anatomical vulnerability, and there is a physiological vulnerability also because of the changes. Emotional changes, they are very much vulnerable to the emotional outburst or emotional depression. Then human trafficking, they are very much vulnerable for trafficking because they are quite mature, by physical maturation is there. They are sexually mature also, but not mentally mature so much. So very much vulnerable for human trafficking. They are social vulnerability by exploiting with the others. And especially the female child, there is early age of teenage pregnancy. Early childbearing, marriage with an older and sexually active male, so they are very much vulnerable for even after marriage sexual exploit. Non-consensual sex, they are vulnerable for that, coercive sex, and of course the child abuse. This is so much so increased in all over the world, there is a POCSO Act for that. That is prevention of sexual offense in children. Inadequate sex education, they also have some wrong belief and wrong misconception about the sex, so it should be they are very much vulnerable for that. So while issuing counseling, we should consider the sex education also. Limited access of to information and counseling, because adolescent, they are very much shy and they don't know where to go, whether they should go on a pediatric OBD or an adult OBD, or whom to counsel, whom to confide his problem. So there is a limited access because adolescent clinic is not available in every way, dedicated adolescent clinics. But I guess the government of India is running adolescent clinic and different medical colleges and district levels. And there's One Nation clinic is named, and that is a dedicated adolescent clinic in district hospitals. So, but the information is not there for the adolescents, so they don't know where to go and where to ask for medical or any help. So there's a limited access for them. The limited access to STD treatment facilities, again, there's no dedicated clinics for them, so they feel shy to go to the general OPD for a sexually transmitted disease and all, so they used to hide, or sometimes that lead to take the advice from the quacks or some problem in connectivity. So I was talking about the eating disorders, then self-harm and suicidal ideations. Is it clear now? Is audio is clear? Okay. So self-harm and suicidal tendency is very common in adolescent group. Recently we have received one patient who just had a small scolding from the parents, and he had a hanging himself, the partial hanging, and he land up with the spastic quadriplegia because of the hypoxic damage of brain. So they are having a impulsivity, and with the impulse they do the self-harm procedures like cutting the radial artery and taking the mosquito coils, repellents, and whatever available in front of them, they'll do the self-harm. So very common for this, you have to make them aware. There's a suicidal prevention day as on 10th September. So we should take care of the adolescent so that they can love themselves. They should not harm themselves. So these counseling issues to be taken while dealing with the adolescents. Then there's a peer pressure and competition. They are always with the peers because they are expending maximum time with the peers. So there is a lots of peer pressures, and they are away from the family, away from the parents. And this is the age where they like to be counseled by the peers rather than the parents. If the parents give something advice and all, they will revolt.
While if the peers say something, they will accept. So there's a peer pressure is there, and there's a competition, both healthy competition and unhealthy competition among the adolescents. Then of course there are economical vulnerability because of disparity in the economical status of the different adolescents. So they are very much in a stress and strain, and they want to have all the gadgets. If they are one of the peer is having some gadgets, the adolescent also want to have all the gadgets which is available. Then they are very much vulnerable for the commercial sex workers, migrant populations. The adolescents are very much vulnerable for that. And of course the child labor, though there is lots of legal issues are there in child labor, lots of protections, laws, and the government of India has having the laws, child abuse and neglect and child labor. I can seal, we say I can seal, there's a law from the government of India, that whoever will give the child for in the labor, recruit the adolescent in labor, they will be punished. But still there's lots of issues regarding the child labor. Now, so counseling is required. We have discussed why they are vulnerable, what are the points we will be taking in account while counseling, and the vulnerability. So we have to counsel regarding the mental health, nutritional health, menstrual health, sexual and reproductive health, lifestyle skills, and as they are suffering from HIV, we will take care of the HIV status, its disclosure, its treatment, its the drug adherence, and the drug side effects. Then adjustment difficulties and developing relationship, so you have to counsel regarding this. Scholastic, if there is a scholastic backwardness, how to improve himself in the scholastic way, and the education and career, it's our responsibility to counsel them about this. Then personality disorders, some very much arrogant, rude, some are very much introvert, shy, so you have to take care of all those things. Then the non-assertive adolescents. In case of non-assertive, they are not expressing feelings, needs, ideas, and ignoring the personal rights and allowing others to infringe upon them. So non-assertive adolescents usually avoid the lack of eye contact and looking down or back. They suffer from loss of confidence, self-esteem, and may lead them less assertive in future. So it's a counselor duty to counsel them, and it is therefore important to break the cycle and learn to be more assertive. Then there may be some psychiatric disorders, nutritional and feeding habits. Again, I have to counsel about the nutrition and feeding habits, because as they are very busy all the time, they are either busy in the education or training or hobbies or work because of the child labor and all. So they are spending much more time outside the house, away from the family. So they want to have a easily available food, and the fast food and junk foods are very easily available, easily taken. So they are inclined towards the fast food and junk food without knowing the side effects and consequences of those type of foods. So the counseling, we have to consider all those issues. Then of course legal aspects, because we know the adolescents are very much vulnerable, and there's a stage of curiosity, experimentation and all. So legal aspects, we have to counsel what are the legal aspects, like even the partners with the consent. So any sexual relationship below sex with a minor girl less than 16 years is considered a rape, and if the legal consent for marriage is less than 18 years is also illegal. So if anyone gives the legal aspects to be explained to the adolescent, because even if the partner gives consent and the girl is less than 16 years, she cannot have, if it is even they have a sexual relationship with the consent, it is considered as a rape. So these legal aspects to be taught the adolescent. And in the again in the marriage also, the girl is less than 18 years and the boy is less than 21 years, is also illegal. So we should give some importance about the legal aspect, legal issues, and it should be dealt with very politely with the adolescents. Then the immunization, again we are very much concerned about our children and the newborns, but we used to forget about the adolescent immunization. As for my experience, whenever we ask about the second booster at the 5 years, they all give the primary immunization up to 9 months, then first booster 18 months, the second booster 5 years, they easily forget. Then of course 10 years maximum they used to forget. So immunization counseling must be is a part of the counseling and overall. then educational opportunities, career related counseling, the choosing the career which is beneficial for which type of individual, because each adolescents are different and we have to deal with the differently. So important counseling now as they are suffering with HIV, so we have to counsel regarding HIV also. So disclosure of their own status, when to disclose to the adolescent about their status and how to disclose, not in the same sitting, it should be in a gradual sitting. Then the as they have they might have infected from the vertical transmission, to disclose the parental status to them. They might do the blame game to the parents if they know they have acquired the infection from the parents. That should be counseled very tenderly. Then the disclosure of their status to others, whether and potential benefits and risks of the supporting to determine the disclosure of their HIV status to others. When to disclose his or her own status to other, what is the benefit and risk? If you disclose, what benefit he'll get? If you won't disclose, what problem he might face? So these things to be considered while discussing about the disclosure. And empowering and supporting to determine if, when, how and to whom to disclose. It's very important the adolescents should know when, how and to whom to disclose their own status. Then dealing with the stigma, how to deal with the stigma and discrimination. Then treatment related counselings, like a pre-RT counseling, what are the things to be done, how he will keep him healthy, and what are the investigation to be done. Excuse me. What are the protocol and where to go, where will they will go to the counseling. Pre-RT counseling must be very strong enough so that the future planning will be in a right path. The importance of treatment adherence and role of medication, why they need treatment, because they will say, I am quite healthy, I am not having any disease, why should I take the medicine? So you have to counsel about the need of the medications and the importance of adherence, what is the importance of adherence, and all those things to be counseled while counseling with the about the treatment issues. And regular follow-up is very important, because if you won't do the follow-up, everything will be at loss. Then dealing with the parental HIV status, how to deal with the parental status of the HIV, and if there's a sickness, parental sickness, how to deal with them, and death, they might have a single both parental death due to HIV. And then of course counseling regarding opportunistic infections and other sexually transmitted infection, healthy lifestyle informations, and about HIV infections, and what is the difference between HIV and what is the difference AIDS, how will you keep them safe, what is the importance of taking the drugs, how will, what is the AIDS and what is the HIV, these differences will be given, information to be given to the adolescent. So mental health is a very important issue nowadays. If you go through the data, it is out of one in five babies are having mental health, but mental health problem, but rarely they go for the treatment or to the counselors. And because of the problems of mental health, they can face the fears, depression, anxiety, stress, worry and panic attack. So Indian Academy of Pediatrics has doing lots of exercise for prevention of the mental health problem. So they are pulled in too many directions, what to do, where to do, where to go, how to confide, where to say my problems, who will listen my problem. And sometimes parents ignore the mental problem. They said, oh, my son or my daughter is very arrogant or rude or very shy. They don't consider it as a mental problem. So it's very important to identify early the mental health problem and consider the counseling regarding the mental health problem from the counselors. Mental health issues are one of the leading cause of mortality and morbidity among adolescents, and one out of five adolescents has a diagnosable mental health. You see, what is the burden of mental health in our society? But only half, means 20% is having mental health problem, only 10% they seek the help from the either counselors or the doctor. The adolescent faces social and emotional changes. As I've already said, if you go to the time lapse in the brain with the, that is a red line to blue line in the brain map, the last to mature is the frontal lobe. So there are lots of problem. Emotional limbic system is already developed by 18 to 19 years, but the frontal lobe develops by the 24 years. So there's a gradual shift from the development, maturation of the brain. So they seeking independence, explore sexual identity, start to build up relationship with both the sexes, both a male and female. The more risk-taking behaviors, emotional ups and downs, they suffer from mood swings, they are very much conscious of the body image, and they influenced by the show, they are or easily influenced by the social media and digital media, print media. Like someone might, some girl might have a idea that he, if she looks beautiful with the fair complexion, they might do the better in the service job. They so they go for the, they have a, some leader in front of in their mind, and they want to copy to be that type of leader. So they might apply, like one example I can give you, like they will see in the digital media, it is very common advertisement. If you apply fair and lovely cream, you will be looking very beautiful and you will get the job. And so they go on the fair and lovely. Similarly, the boys, they have some protein supplements, is very much rampant advertisement in the TVs and all. So they go for the that protein supplement, as if they will take the protein supplement, they will have a biceps, prominent biceps, and they have a good body. So these are the influenced by the social media, and that should be counseled while dealing with the adolescents. So they are in a depressed mood, diminished interest in the surroundings or himself or herself. Sometimes they are away from, they don't want to take the any activities or social activities inside the family members or with the relatives. Decrease or increase in appetite, there's poor sleep, sleep disturbances, they are easy fatigue. They feel they are worthless, excessive guilt, and this is the phase where they will go for the self-harm. And someday they are in very much in confusion, and they are suffer from a phase of indecisiveness. And then that lead to the suicidal ideations. They try to commit suicide. There are lots of complications, because we have seen many cases they have tried for suicide, and sometimes they are survived by the handicapping. One of my adolescent patient, he did the hanging, and it was a partial hanging, and now he survived by the all the intensive care doctors and all. Now he has landed up with the quadriparesis. Similarly, another one has having only the vegetative body. So these are the suicide. They develop all those because of the mental health problem, that they end into the suicidal ideations, and sometimes they are successful, sometimes they are not successful. So depression is very important, and we should deal with this issues very tenderly and very confidently, and confidentiality to be maintained while dealing with these issues. Now, what about the sexuality? Adolescent sexuality is a very important issue. We should discuss about the sexuality. So we say talk the talk before they walk the walk. So it's from the home we have to teach our kids. From the very beginning, like the mother will teach the girl child about the menstruation, the menarche, what should be, what is the consequence of menarche. If she will, now after the menarche, you will teach the girl that now you are capable of having the pregnancy and producing kid and all. These things to be, what precaution you should take, and all those advice will start from at home. So sexual health, we'll talk about the counseling regarding the sexuality. What is it? It is a central aspect of being human throughout life, and encompassing the sex, gender, identities, role, and sexual orientations. So sexuality, you have to describe about the what is the gender, what do you mean by gender parity, and there should not be gender disparity. That should be counseled in the very beginning, so they can pay respect to the others also, the opposite genders also. Then of course we have to consider while counseling the sexual development, what are the phases. It is a normal, sometimes external and internal development. I have seen a patient, adolescent patient, was very much in depression. Then we inquired that she had a menarche, and she didn't say to anyone that she has a menarche. She thought she is having hematuria, blood in urine, and she has a kidney cancer, and she is going to die, because she didn't have any information regarding menarche when she was an early adolescent. So these things can happen. So we should counsel regarding sexual development. Then sexual activities, different facts, different issues regarding their sexual activities, health issues related to sex, what problem they can have, and if there's unsafe sex, what are the disease can be transmitted, if she can she might get pregnant, if she might get pregnant, what are the problems in the teenage pregnancy, all those to be dealt while dealing with the adolescents. Then how to prevent and what the screening of STIs, how to stay safe if at all they are having STI, where to go and where they will get the counseling and treatment regarding STIs. And of course, role of life skills and understanding the relationship. So we have to counsel them about the safe sex, unsafe sex, sexual maturity, cultural regulations, sexual harassment, sexual health, sexual exploitation with the close, especially by the close contacts, and sexual taboos to be removed. Now the next important part is the nutritional health. As I've already said, they spend much more time outside the home and they are very busy, so they are much more inclined towards the easily available food. So they go for the fast food or the junk foods, which is easily available all over the roadside foods. So there are lots of complications. They don't know the consequences. And if you say, don't do this, it will do this harm in the future. They don't bother for the future. Suppose I'll give you one example. If you say to the adolescent, don't smoke, and do you know, if you smoke, what problem will be there? They will say, I know, there will be lung cancer. But they will think, oh, lung cancer, when I will be adult, then it will be lung cancer. And now, lots of people are smoking, not all people are having lung cancer. So they will listen to this side effect. But if you say, oh, you are smoking, your lips will be black, your teeth will be yellow, when you laugh, your black teeth will come out, the yellow teeth will come out, no one, your other peers won't look at you. If you are a male child, male adolescent, the girls are not going to look at you because of the yellow teeth and black lip. That will create much more impact than the, if you say it will cause the lung cancer. So immediate impact is very important for the adolescent than the future impact. Similarly, in the nutritional health, we have to counsel why it is important to have a right food in the right moment and a right amount, because of it's a phase of growth and rapid growth and development. The growth and development starts from the day of conception. When the mother conceives, from that day it is growing, baby is growing. But the adolescent phase is a rapid phase of growth, both sexually, mentally and physically, and development. So general health, it will also increase the general health and increase the immunity. Then there will be a good skin and hair. If you say that, they will be very much conscious about the food. Then it will increase the activity levels, school performance, attention span, cognition and behavioral improvement. So we have to counsel regarding the type of food and what is the importance of vitamins, not only the junk food and fast food or the staple diet. We have to counsel regarding the role of vitamins and minerals, why it is important. So we have to explain what is food pyramid, which type of food should be taken adequately, which food should eat liberally, which food we should take moderately, and which food we should take very little in amount, what will be the consequences. So you just counsel them about the immediate impact. If it's a long-term impact, they're not going to listen. This is the phase of, the adolescent phase is the phase of denial. So it is always better to say the immediate impact. If you take this much, you will be fatty, you will be disfigured. So they will concentrate on the good food. So now, as the issues to be dealt by the counselors, the counselor follows some rules and regulations. So there are some tips for the counselor. So develop a good rapport with the client, develop good listening skills, observe the counselee's action, strong self-esteem must be there, they should have a genuine concern for the client. The counselor should be very open, flexible, should not be rigid or have an own idea, it should be flexible. Counselor should be trustworthy so that the adolescent can trust the counselor. Very understanding, we have to listen to the problem very patiently, so be patient. And always give the respect, because everyone, even the kids and the infants and child and adult, we know as adult, all the person, our human beings need respect. So why not the adolescent? We should pay respect to the adolescent, give due respect and talk. Use a good non-harmful humor. So just to make the environment very friendly, you can use some humor which is not harmful for them. And the counselor should avoid the interrogating mode, as if he is a teacher and he is a student, he is asking the question, he is going to answer. It's not that. So there should not be any interrogating mode. You should not impose your values on them, let them what they are coming for. There should be no blaming attitude. Oh, you have done this, you have eaten lots of junky food, that's why you have this pimple. So we should not do the blaming game. We should avoid the blaming attitude. We should give sufficient time, inadequate time. When the adolescent is explaining his problem, you are watching at your wrist and moving your eyes here and there looking for the paper, and that will give some disinterest in the adolescent, and they are not going to say everything to you. So give enough time for the adolescent, and should avoid the advice, look too hastily for a solution. Don't go in a hasty solution, just take a time and gradual improvement, and should not use the technical jargon which may confuse the adolescents or scare the adolescent. Now there are some stages of counseling, because on very first day you are not going to tell everything whatever you know. You cannot impose your knowledge to the adolescent, so it should be gradual rapport building should be there. I'll discuss the gather approach and heads approach. So stage one is the relationship building. You have to make a really good relation. So you just call by name, like Mr. X, oh please come sit your take your chair. Oh, this your shirt is very good. Mother gave this shirt, or you have bought this shirt for puja occasion. So you just divert this environment in a different friendly manner, so you can have a good relationship with the adolescent. Then assessment and diagnosis. Stage two is the assessment, and you have to be very intelligent. Why he has come? What is the problem he is facing? Because she might have problems something else, and you'll explain something else. Because they are very introvert, very shy. They have come to the different place, very much aware of the environment, and they are very much scared about the identification. They might be identified by their friends, by their the friends' parents and all. So that should be very much. You should deal with the adolescent very much. Confidentiality to be maintained, and so assessment is very important. Gradual assessment: why he has come, what is the problem he is having, and so you make a diagnosis. Then you make a few objectives. How to achieve the goal? What is your goal? You want to make the adolescent to empower them about the HIV status or the disclosure or his mental health or the nutritional health. So you have a goal in your mind, and make some few objectives how to reach that goal. So formulation of a counseling goals is very important. Then stage four is the intervention and problems. Now you have achieved some goal, some objectives. Then you just go gradually increase for intervention. What intervention the person need? Whether he needs intensive counseling or some investigations or other counselors, or it may be with the parents counseling. So just think of the intervention and try to solve the problem. And the last stage is the termination and follow-up. It's not the least step, because follow-up is very important. If the adolescent don't come again and again, then your counseling is not just successful counseling. So follow-up is a very important part of the counseling. Now, what are the types of counseling? It's very important for the adolescent. You can counsel in the individual counseling, the one adolescent at a time separately, confidentiality to maintain in a separate room. Or you can do the family counseling, some normal topic you can counsel with the parents. So always take the consent of the adolescent. It's very important for counseling. You know, okay, I am calling your parents. Okay, you explain everything in front of the parents. If they say yes, so you can do the family counseling. Then you can go for the couple counseling. If two couples have come with the adolescent couple, then you can counsel together. Then the group counseling. You can have a group. All the adolescent, you make a group of adolescent. You can counsel at one time on a group. So the common issues will be dealt with the group counseling, and the different issues which have individualized, you can deal with the different in the individual counseling. Then you can make a group of non-homogeneous group or a homogeneous group. Means only the female adolescents are counseled together, and the male adolescents are counseled together. Or can I make a group of male and female adolescents counseled together, where you can counsel about the gender parity, so that the how to pay respect to the other genders. All this can be counseled together. Then it could be open group, means you can counsel in the open, or you make a smaller closed group for the different counseling. So these are the types of counseling. It should be individualized and that to be followed. when face to face with a health worker or an adult staff member, because in the IT center or in the doctor's OPD, everyone is adult, quite mature, and the adolescents are in an immature phase, so they are facing with the health worker who are adult. So what they feel, they shy and about being in clinical and needing to discuss personal matters. They're very shy to disclose their own problem. Embarrassed, and they are seeking assistance on a taboo topic like HIV. They might feel embarrassed that I'm asking about HIV, I'm asking about sex, I'm asking about the condoms, I'm asking about the contraceptives. Worried about the someone will see them and tell their parents that he has come to the STI clinic or he has come to the adolescent clinic. So these are the issues: inadequate and describing their concern, ill-informed health matters, anxious, they have serious condition, they might die. These are the issues they might face. Defensive attitudes, so they will follow. They will resistant to receive help. They will deny. They are always in a denial mode. So they will resistant to take the help. Unsure about how to ask or help related to living with HIV, whether they will ask or not, whether they will say everything to the counselor or not, they are very unsure. And they should be loyal to the health workers with whom they have a long established relationship. So good relationship with the boon of the counseling. Hopeful that clinical staff can provide them with a care that will make them more comfortable and able to live a normal life. Okay, I'll go through the case study. There are few cases. 18 years old, was HIV infected, and she discloses to the boyfriend, and to her surprise, broke up with her immediately. Now she is not only the heartbroken, but also worried that her ex-boyfriend will, out of spite, disclose her HIV status to others. So how do you proceed with them? So counselor, now he has to identify what are the issues. She is having HIV one issue. Second issue is the breakup. Third issue is the stigma and discrimination, and that will be dealt separately. Similarly, if you take this another case, a 15 years old, having living with HIV since she was an infant, so it is from the vertical transmission. Her mother passed away and few years ago. She lives with her father now. She is responsible for caring for three younger siblings. She comes to the clinic with a claim that she is having some stomach pain. But you suspect the real reason is she has come is something else. Again, you have to deal with, now she is an adolescent, having lost mother, taking care of the three kids and having stomach pain. But might be not stomach pain, it might be sexually abused because mother is not there at home. So then be sexually abused, she might get pregnancy. So these issues to be dealt. If you think of that, so I am not going to the slides. Another case, 16-year-old young man who tested positive for HIV for 4 weeks ago. So new case. When you see him at clinic today, he appears upset. He said that he has not told anyone about HIV status. He is not doing well in the school. He feels really angry most of the time. His girlfriend is threatening to break up with him because of his moodiness. When you ask him question, he gives you short response in an angry voice. So he is having the HIV one issue. Second issue is a mental health problem. So these things to be counseled separately. So in a nutshell, what are the issues related to counseling in adolescents? As this decision to undergo HIV testing and can be facilitated. HIV is a life-threatening, lifelong disease. Physical, psychological, sociological implication of HIV, prevention of HIV transmission and feeding issues, improvement of quality of life and positive living, ensure the treatment adherence, and the counseling regarding stigma, discrimination related HIV. So according to the US Department of Health Human Service panel, ERT guidelines, many adolescents have a medication related side effects, denial mode, misinformed, distrusted, fear and lack of belief in effective medications, low self-esteem, and there's a chaotic lifestyle, unavailable or inconsistent to the access of care. So LFU much more common, or missed, and LFU both much more common in adolescent groups. So counseling should be in a gather approach, as I already said. You should greet, assess the child's problem, tell them the exact informations, help them to take the decision, explain and misunderstanding to be removed, a return to follow-up must be done. So in conclusion, HIV infected adolescents are a unique challenge, and accepting and treating the disease, many adolescents are in a denial mode. Providing care to adolescents is a multifaceted problem. For clinician, caring adolescent is a crucial understanding the issues of the adolescent,
reaching youngster at an impressionable age before they may become sexually active is very important. Adolescent HIV AIDS is an epidemic with a difference, and its control needs to be adolescent specific and is to be different. So thank you for patient sharing. If there's any queries or questions regarding counseling issues in the adolescent, you can ask me or don't write me in my mail.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this informative session. Thanks to all the participants for patient listening. All participants are requested to kindly enter the e-poll, which will be displayed on the screen shortly. Thank you very much.
Thank you.